So up to now, we've been considering, in general terms, oxygenic photosynthesis, but some bacteria don't generate oxygen. This is anoxygenic photosynthesis. And these bacteria, like for example, the one shown here, which is a purple non-sulfur bacterium, uses a reaction center with a maximal absorbance at 840 nanometers, or lambda, in other words, wavelength light. And it captures energy much like any photosystem would. Electrons are excited to a high energy state, and they are passed to electron acceptors, and in the process, ATP can be generated via chemiosmosis because hydrogen ions are pumped, which allows ATP synthase to come into action and make ATP. But the electrons are eventually recycled directly back to the photosystem. So here, water does not contribute an electron to replace electrons lost by the photosystem. Rather, there's a cyclic flow of electrons. And interestingly enough, in the purple non-sulfur bacteria, if you look at their photosystem, it has homology to photosystem 2 of plants and advanced photosystems. We'll see the role of photosystem 2 in those organisms shortly. But there's a significant homology of the purple non-sulfur bacteria photosystems to photosystem 2 of plants. So we'll look at that shortly. In addition, there's also a cyclic, green sulfur bacteria use cyclic photophosphorylation as well, in which the electrons are cycled back to the photosystem. And here, hydrogen is produced when electrons join a proton. And these sulfur bacteria use hydrogen sulfide as an electron donor. But neither these bacteria nor the purple non-sulfur bacteria have photosystems that have enough oxidative power to accept electrons from water. And so we don't have oxygenic photosynthesis in these cases. And both these cases involve cyclic photophosphorylation, in which electrons are recycled back to the photosystems. Now it's time to move on to the main types of photosynthesis that we'll be talking about, in which chloroplasts of plants, for example, conduct. And there we're looking at two linked photosystems. Oh, before I do that, though, I want to point out that in sulfur bacteria, the photosystem here, photosystem is homologous to photosystem. This is the photosystem of the green sulfur bacteria. And their photosystem, it has homology to photosystem 1 found in chloroplasts, that is, in higher plants. So there's some interesting homologies there. And when we get to, now we're going to get to the non-cyclic photophosphorylation that occurs in chloroplasts. Here we have two linked photosystems, which have homologies to the cyclic photosystems that we looked at previously. But here we have non-cyclic photophosphorylation, non-cyclic transfer of electrons, because electrons are contributed by water. Chloroplasts have the ability, there's enough oxidative power to actually accept electrons from water. So we have photosystem 1, and it has a reaction center with a peak absorption at 700 nanometers. We'll see how that works shortly. And photosystem 2 has an absorption peak at 680 nanometers. So these are two linked photosystems that operate in tandem to provide the energy that will be used to drive the fixation of carbon in subsequent light-independent reactions. These, of course, are light-dependent. So let's look at photosystem 2. It acts first. And photosystem 2, as I've said, resembles the reaction center of purple bacteria, purple non-sulfur bacteria. And there's 10 transmembrane protein subunits with electron transfer components associated, and as well, two chlorophyll A molecules that have an absorption peak at 680 nanometers. Now, this reaction center, although homologous to that of purple bacteria, this photosystem rather, that is homologous to the reaction center of purple bacteria, differs in that it contains four manganese ions, and these are what's essential for the oxidation of water, for accepting electrons from water, in other words, and producing molecular oxygen. So this is oxygenic photosynthesis that we're talking about. And in addition, there is the B6F complex, which is a proton pump that's embedded in the thylakoid membrane within chloroplasts. So be sure you understand your chloroplast morphology and where thylakoids reside inside the chloroplast. And this B6F complex will transfer electrons, and in so doing, will use the energy obtained by subsequent electron transfer to pump protons from the outside the thylakoid to the inside of the thylakoid, thus creating a hydrogen ion that is a proton gradient. Now, photosystem 1 will then come into play, and it has a reaction center that has 12 to 14 protein subunits, depending on the organism that you're talking about, and there are two P700 chlorophyll molecules that are involved in the reaction center there, in the core of the photosystem. And photosystem 1 will be accepting electrons from plastocyanin, as we will see, and it accepts electrons because photosystem 1 absorbs light energy and excites electrons in its reaction center to high energy that is passed on to other electron acceptors, and those electrons are replaced from electrons coming from plastocyanin. Ultimately, though, those electrons are going to be coming from photosystem 2, and therefore ultimately from water. Now, what photosystem 1 does is when its electrons are excited by the absorption of photons, it passes electrons to NADP+, and then reduces NADP+ to NADPH. And this will be used in the light-independent reactions, as will ATP generated by chemiosmosis, as we will see. So here's a schematic of the whole process. And downstream of this whole process, let's keep things in perspective. The goal of this process is to produce two types of molecules, NADPH, which is an electron carrier, and ATP. And those two molecules, NADPH and ATP, produced by the light-dependent reactions in the thylakoid membrane, will be used to drive the Calvin cycle, which involves the fixation of carbon from carbon dioxide into organic molecules. So that's our goal here, is to fix carbon and produce food, to produce carbohydrates, food that sustains all life on Earth eventually. So let's go through this system now sequentially. We have photons of light that are absorbed by photosystem 2 first. And those electrons are excited to a high energy state and transferred to plastoquinone. Those electrons are replaced by the oxidation of water, yielding hydrogen ions and molecular oxygen. And this is why plants breathe out oxygen. They provide the oxygen that exists in our atmosphere. And that comes from water. So water donates electrons that replaces the electrons that are lost by photosystem 2 to plastoquinone. Now, what does plastoquinone do with those electrons? It transfers them to the B6F complex, which is a complex of proteins that transfer electrons sequentially within the complex, and in so doing, use that energy transfer, the subsequent loss of electron energy in each transfer, to pump hydrogen ions into the inside of the thylakoid space, in other words. Out here we have the stroma of the chloroplast. Here is the thylakoid space interiorly. So that you can see we are getting hydrogen ions from the splitting of water, and we're also pumping hydrogen ions into the thylakoid space. And those hydrogen ions that are concentrated inside the thylakoid space represent a proton gradient across the thylakoid. And here we have ATP synthase that is capable of using that proton gradient in the same way that we studied cellular respiration, ATP synthase, to drive the phosphorylation of ADP and therefore the formation of ATP. And this molecule will be used in the light independent reactions to help drive the Calvin cycle, as we will see. Well, let's get back to our electrons and skip the protons for the time being. As B6F complex has transferred these electrons through it, those electrons are now donated to plastocyanin, another electron carrier. And plastocyanin donates electrons to photosystem 1. So you see photosystem 1 acts after photosystem 2. And photosystem 1 captures light energy, excites electrons to a high energy state, and transfer those to ferredoxin. Those electrons are replaced not from water as in photosystem 2, but those electrons are replaced from the electrons coming in from plastocyanin. And where did plastocyanin get those electrons? From the B6F complex. And where did the B6F complex get those electrons? From plastoquinone. And where did plastoquinone get those electrons? It got them from photosystem 2. And where did photosystem 2 replace the electrons lost by excitation through the capture of light energy? It gets those electrons from water. So you can work through this process backwards to see where the source of electrons are for all these processes. Photosystem 1 passes electrons to ferredoxin, which passes electrons to the NADP ferredoxin reductase, NADP reductase, and that protein complex actually complexed with ferredoxin actually then reduces NADP plus to NADPH. So it accepts a proton and it accepts electrons to form NADPH, which is an electron carrier. So the net result of this, of the light dependent reactions in chloroplasts, is the production of ATP via chemiosmosis and the production of NADPH by reduction of NADP. And this is accomplished through both of these are accomplished through electron transfer. One process of electron transfer generates a proton gradient that can be used to drive chemiosmosis using ATP synthase to make ATP. And the other process of electron transfer involves the reduction of NADP plus to NADPH. Both of these molecules, NADPH and ATP, then are used to drive the Calvin cycle, which fixes carbon from carbon dioxide into organic molecules, into glucose, which is the ultimate source of carbohydrate and therefore food for all living systems. So we can review this briefly, and I'll do that next. We remember that photosystem 2 acts first, and the antennal complex, the accessory pigments, shuttle energy to the reaction center, which has an absorption maximum at 680. And we know that excited electrons from P680 are transferred to the B6F complex, electron transport complex, and that the electrons lost from photosystem 2 are replaced from electrons from water, yielding oxygen, oxygenic photosynthesis, in other words. We know that the B6F complex is a series of electron carriers, and they are embedded in the thylakoid membrane, as already discussed, and they pump protons into the thylakoid space to form a proton gradient in response to the electron transfer that occurs within them. They harness the energy of electron transfer to accomplish that pumping, creating that proton gradient. And electrons then are transferred to photosystem 1 eventually. We know that photosystem 1 receives energy from an antenna complex, just like photosystem 2, and that energy is shuttled to P700 reaction center, an absorption peak of at 700 nanometers, and that excited electron is transferred to a membrane-bound electron carrier, and that those electrons are used to reduce NADP plus, NADP plus to NADPH. And those electrons are replaced from electrons coming from the B6F complex, which of course, remember, get their electrons from ultimately the photosystem 2, and then really ultimately at the first stage, water. And we'll pick up our review in the next section of this lecture.